Well, greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Welcome to worship with Ramona Avenue Christian Church. I'm Dr. Matt, as always, and we are here to worship God, to sing and hear the word, and maybe even chuckle, because I'm doing that new sermon series on humor in the Bible. So we'll see if I can pull something out. But like I said last week, though, this is not going to be a stand-up comedy routine. Hopefully, no, I don't think I can pull that off. But we are glad to be together in worship, and let's see, a couple words about today's service. We will be taking communion later, so if you have something to eat, something to drink, we'll be taking communion together. I think that's all the announcements. So with that, invite us to continue into our worship as we sing together the Lord's Prayer. Come to our time of prayer, we have a joy. Today is a special day, right? It's Mike's birthday.
Happy birthday.
Not only that, but Mike is here with his new hand. I mean, his repaired. His newly repaired. Newly repaired hand. So, and such a tiny scar. I'm. That's wild. They can do it like that. So. Oh, yeah. So, really, praise God that you were able to get that. Finally, it got it all together and everything happened. And also, a happy birthday. So, okay. We want to be continuing to pray for the places of conflict. There have been some fresh attacks in the war in Ukraine. A number of people killed there. And, of course, the ongoing war in Gaza. Now, the number of Palestinians have been killed in this war now is top 25,000. Again, with estimates that up to 70% of those are women and children. The horrific attacks on October 7th set off this war with a whole series, and we've had fresh reporting too on the way that the pervasive nature of sexual assault and rape during that attack by Hamas and other Palestinians. And now this war where the Israeli government is just bombarding Gaza out of existence. And so really want to be praying that something would intervene, that cool heads would somehow prevail, that people would get the humanitarian aid they need, that there could be healing and an end to the trauma that these two peoples are just imposing on each other over and over again. I have some other sad news. Most of you, I think, will remember Sean Coaster, who was here as part of our congregation years ago. I just found out yesterday that he passed away in mid-December. I don't have any other details other than that, but the service was on Friday. Sean was a pastor here in our region, and he had years ago, I was trying to remember how many years, but quite a few years back, he was part of our congregation for a while as he was a student at the Claremont School of Theology. He preached here a few times and participated in life with us. And then got his MDiv, went on, was ordained, and was pastoring a church. Last I know, he was pastoring a church out in San Bernardino. Again, I don't have many other details other than he leaves a wife, Heather, who I think he married. I think they were dating when he was here. So they did get married. They were married at least 6 years, I think. And so we want to be praying for Heather as she's mourning her loss of her husband and everyone in that congregation that he has served with and ministered to over the years. Sean was a unique guy, to say the least, but he had a big heart and a lot of love for God and for people, and it was quite a shock to hear that he had died. He was 38, I believe, so it was way too early. I'll say in other prayers, I've been asking prayers for my wife Jenny off and on. I will say that some more recent treatments that she's been doing seem to be having a pretty good effect. She's been actually doing quite a bit better. We're holding it kind of tentatively, as she is, because you never know with depression and also hormones and all the different things that are going on. You just never know where it's going to go. But she does seem to be doing quite a bit better. She started teaching a class. This past week, so I would ask prayers for that. She's really enjoying it so far, and I think it's going to be a really good thing, but just prayers that it continues to go well, and that her job continues to go well, and that the administration is favorable toward her and what she's trying to do at Pomona College. So thank you for your prayers and for continued prayers. Oh, and a praise, you guys are in your new house. Yeah, so praise God. Got moved in last weekend and before. It was a process. But now you're all in and you're out. And you had to walk through it, everything, so you're out. The old place is just, now you're in one place. So praise God for that. And you got more space and pray that you continue to be settled in, and pray blessings over your new home. So that's great. And to coincide with your 15th dateversary, pretty close there. So awesome. All right. Well, let us go to God in prayer. God, we really see the breadth of the human experience in our lives. I mean, we are human. And so we bring it all before you, God. The joys, the sorrows, the shock, the devastation, the anger, the hope. All of it, God, we bring it before you. We rejoice with those who rejoice. Wes and Chris, the new house, may it be a blessed place of sanctuary, a home where they can feel themselves, where they can live to their fullest and be a blessing to you and to those around them. We rejoice with Mike on the surgery, and his hand is doing much better, and for his birthday, making it around the sun one more time. Always a good thing, right? God, we also rejoice that my wife Jenny is doing better somewhat, and pray that that'll continue. But God, we also, our hearts break as we hear news of the deaths in so many parts of the world. More people dying in Ukraine, many more in Gaza. And Pastor Sean, closer to home. God, weep with those who weep. Bring comfort and be close to those who are in sorrow. We look forward to the day where every tear is wiped from our eyes and we see you in new ways, in a new world. But until that day, God, come and comfort your people in their pain. God, I pray that you would smack a few folks upside the head in the Holy Land, if necessary. Get those people to talk to each other, to come to some agreements. Help them to see reason as much as there is, to try to bring something out of the absolute chaotic, traumatic mess that this has become. God, we give you thanks that we can bring all these things to you, good and bad, hopeful and despairing. In the name of your Son, who knew the heights of celebration, as at the wedding at Cana, and the depths of despair, as when he cried, my God, why have you forsaken me? It's in his name we pray. Amen. And now Wes is,
Can I just add one more?
You can add one more. I thought of another one too.
Her dad passed away this week. And he'd been a little while.
Okay, so your daughter-in-law Michelle's dad passed away.
For her and her family.
Okay, so we're praying for Michelle and her family on the passing of her dad. I thought of one while I was praying too. Jenny's grandmother, who's 102. I think she may have come at least once. She doesn't get out much anymore, but she's 102 now, and she had a stroke in the past week or so, I think it was, and so things are looking kind of dicey there. But at this point, a comfortable end, I think she'd be fine, because she is, mentally she's kind of moving on already. So Jenny did get a chance to FaceTime with her and talk with her, so that was good. So pray for the family as they await what may be coming soon. We don't know. All right. Well, now, Wes, I'm going to have you read our scripture now. So.
Today's scripture readings are from Genesis. Genesis 2, 7 through 9. The Lord God formed the human from the topsoil of the fertile land and blew life's breath into his nostrils. The human came to life. The Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east and put there the human he had formed. In the fertile land, the Lord God grew every beautiful tree with edible fruit, and also he grew the tree of life in the middle of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Genesis 2:15 through 25. 3, 1. The Lord God took the human and settled him in the Garden of Eden to farm it and to take care of it. The Lord God commanded the human, "Eat your fill from all of the garden's trees, but don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, because on the day you eat from it, you will die." Then the Lord God said, "It's not good that the human is alone. I will make him a helper that is perfect for him." So the Lord God formed from the fertile land all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky and brought them to the human to see what he would name them. The human gave each living being its name. The human named all the livestock, all of the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals. But a helper perfect for him was nowhere to be found. So the Lord God put the human into a deep and heavy sleep, and took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh over it. With the rib taken from the human, the Lord God fashioned a woman and brought her to the human being. The human said, "This one finally is bone from my bones and flesh from my flesh. She will be called a woman, because from a man she was taken. This is the reason that a man leaves his father and mother and embraces his wife, and they become one flesh. The two of them were naked, the man and his wife, but they weren't embarrassed." The snake was the most intelligent of all the wild animals that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say that you shouldn't eat from any tree in the garden?" Genesis 3:20. The man named his wife Eve, because she is the mother of everyone who lives.
So human life and a snake walk into a garden. And the snake says, sounds like the beginning of a strange joke, right? Human life and a snake walk into a garden. And then the snake's the one who says something. Well, that's kind of what's going on in Genesis 2 and 3. These couple chapters, excuse me, the Bible begins with Genesis 1, which we're probably fairly familiar with. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was formless and void, right? It was chaotic. So God's Spirit hovers over the waters. And over the course of these 6 days, you get the growing amount of organization and order. And it's a very orderly telling. And then you get to chapter 2. And it's almost like chapter 2 is kind of the riff on what you just read in chapter 1. Right? Chapter 1, very stately, very, it is, everything is organized and perfect as it should be. And then you get to chapter 2 and God is digging around in the dirt and walking in a garden. It's quite a different story. One of the things that's going on in that story, though, is there are a bunch of wordplays. This is where I got the sermon title, which is a punny creation, because there are wordplays all over this thing. So I'll just tell you about a few of them. So the first one comes when the human is created, right? The very first human is created, and you know his name. Anybody? Adam. Yeah. Shortest poem, by the way. It's called Microbes. Adam Haddam. I don't remember where I heard that, but so Adam, right, Adam in Hebrew, and for the first part of the story, he's referred to as Ha-Adam, which is the human, right? The word Adam means human, so that's why when I said human comes into a bar, the guy's name was human, so he's like, "Hey, how's it going? I'm human." It's like, yeah, you and everybody else. But there wasn't anybody else. He was by himself, right? First human, Adam. Now, when you get to chapter 2, verse 7, it tells us how he was created. It says that God took some dust from the Adama, the ground, the fertile ground. It's a special word for ground that means like this is like plowable soil that you can work. And so you get the Adam from the Adama. It's a wordplay. And it's hard to capture that in English. You could say couple options I've heard are an earthling from the earth. Sounds a little sci-fi to me, but come earthling from the earth. Or humans from the humus. Kind of works. Groundling from the ground. But we're basically dirt folks. And actually, as I was working on the sermon, I realized that I remember when I was younger, it was not uncommon to call somebody a dirtbag. You know, if you wanted to, it was an insult. And I thought, well, actually, that takes on a different meaning when you really know what, you know, where we came from. It's like, yes, thank you, I am a dirtbag. But I have God's breath, so I'm okay. I'm actually a human, yeah. So we're earthy creatures, right? That's one of the first things we learn in Genesis, is that we are of the earth. We are earthlings. Now, the first thing that's not good in all of creation, anybody remember what it is? The first thing that's not good? Because Genesis 1, remember, everything's good. It's good, it's good, it's good. It's very good, extremely good. Now it's good. You get to chapter 2, and something's bad. Something's not good. It doesn't actually say bad. It says not good. And it's that the person, the Adam, is bad, which is Hebrew for alone. I mean, how does that work? It's like a cross, that's like a multilingual pun, right? The word for alone, it's bad that the human is alone, but the word for alone is bad. Yeah, do with that what you want. Helps my students, though, when they're trying to learn their words. It's like, it's bad to be alone. So God goes and is like, okay, I'm going to make some, let's make a companion for this human. And so God grabs some more of that adama, some more of that ground. He's like, hey, it worked once, let's go. Starts making creatures. Sends them over to Adam, and he's like, I don't know about you, but I'm going to call you a cow. Get out of here. I'll call you a lion. Go. Mosquito. Dang it. You know, all these creatures, God's making all these creatures out of the dirt. So I guess that's one thing we have in common with all the animals. Made from dirt. Dirt creatures. And God's like, none of these are partner material here. Right? And God's like, these are cool creatures. I like them. You can give them some names. But nobody's partner material yet. Can't find anything that corresponds to Adam. It's like, well, what are we going to do? So then he says, I know what I'll do. Puts Adam to sleep. The human. Puts the human to sleep and takes part of his body. Right? And what part of the body was it? Yeah, we're told it's a rib. Funnily, is that a word? Interestingly, the word doesn't ever mean rib anywhere else, the Hebrew word there. Doesn't mean rib anywhere. It means the side. Now you can see why they translate a rib, but it means the side of something. But it refers to, let's see, I wrote it down here, the side of the ark, right? When they're building the ark building the ark, or the tabernacle, right? The housing of God's presence in the wilderness, or the side of the altar. So this ark, or this rib, is really more like a side beam, some kind of structural thing. And it's used mostly in the context of holy things. So we get Eve, who's built, the word used when God, right? So there's different words for making things in Hebrews, right? So at the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That's bara, it's creation, right? When God forms the human, it's yatsara, that's a forming, right? Yatsar, starting from stuff, right? He used the adama. But now he builds a woman, bana. And there's some good jokes in there, I bet. But moving on. I don't know, just really well built. put together. Eve, you know, God did a good job. But God built Eve from the holy side, whatever that means. And then we find out the Adam, who, by the way, has not been identified as male or female up to this point. The word from man and woman have not shown up in the passage at all so far. God takes this creature that God has made out of the holy side of the human, brings it to the human, and the human says, "Hey, this is it! Bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh, yes! And so I will call her Isha, because she came from Ish." Ish means man, Isha, woman. And it's kind of funny because it's very similar to the way in English, right? You have Ish as man, Isha, woman. In English, it's man and woman. Yeah. I remember as a kid growing up in church, you're sitting there, and the pastor after the sermon, you know, "Our gracious Heavenly Father," that's how the pastor always started the prayer after the sermon when I was a kid. "Our gracious Heavenly Father," blah, 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 and they'd say, "Amen." And I always thought, why not all women? But, you know, it took a while. I found out later, you know, that's just the word. Amen. It's Hebrew, actually. So he's really excited to finally see a creature that corresponds to him. And he's like, yes, this is awesome. I'm going to name her. Just like I named everybody else, right? I gave everybody else a name. I'll give her a name. And her name means from me. Yes. He does give her a different name later. And that was the last verse that Wes read in chapter 3. The end of chapter 3, he names her Chava, or in English we say Eve, which means life. He names her life because she's the mother of all living. And I hadn't really paid attention to this before, but he does this, he names her that, before she's ever given birth, which kind of makes you wonder. What was going on there? It's the next chapter. She gives birth. Now, a little later in the passage, it tells us, right, that they're, you know, they come from one from the other, and bone from my bone, and all that. And this is why a man leaves his house and goes and cleaves to his wife, and they become one flesh, and all that. Except that somebody in the ancient world reading that, well, wait a second. Man doesn't leave the house to go cleave to his wife. The woman leaves to go to the husband. It's a patriarchal society. So the Bible's actually flipped it. One of only about 500 times that the Bible does that, where it flips social convention on its head. It isn't that the woman has to be bought with this dowry and then she is brought to the man. No, the man goes, leaves his home, finds a wife. So find that interesting. It's playing with gender there. But my favorite joke, and I was telling our youngest Marnie about this morning, and she thought this was a good one too, but she kind of liked the others, but I told her this one. I said, you know, you get toward the end of the chapter there, and it says that they were the man and his woman, whatever, they were naked and not ashamed. Right, they didn't matter. They didn't know anybody. They didn't know any difference. So, you know, yeah. Strangely enough, I was actually reading an article in the Atlantic, I think it was, just a day or two ago, about scientists trying to figure out when humans started wearing clothes, and it was kind of fascinating, because it was probably tens of thousands of years ago, if not longer, and maybe not just Homo sapiens. Interesting. It's hard, though, because the, you know, fabric doesn't last. No matter what you make clothes out of, it's not really going to last. So they have to go off of kind of indirect things. But we've got clothing, actual clothing, going back about 5,000 years. But people before that probably weren't naked, because we didn't have fur, and it gets cold sometimes. All right, so now they were nude, right? And the term there is arom. The word is arom, but in this verse it's spelled arum. So they were arum and not ashamed. And then the very next verse we're told the snake was the most arumim of all God's creatures. The most clever, sneaky, shrewd, right? But there is an obvious play on words here, because naked, arum. Clever, arum. Im. They just add an ending on it, but it's basically the same. It sounds exactly the same. It's spelled almost exactly the same in Hebrew. This is a clear word play. And so how do you translate that? They were nude, and the snake was shrewd. I kind of like that one. Nude and shrewd. They were naked, and the snake was wicked. No. I don't know. Something, though, right? It's a play on words there. So either we're supposed to think about the snake being like the most nude of any of God's creatures, or Adam and Eve were actually shrewd and not ashamed, maybe. And then I looked into it a little more, and it turns out the word for nude in at the end of chapter 2, the word comes from a root that means smooth, which kind of makes sense, right? Smooth, nude. Okay, you can see the connection. But then I thought, ooh, smooth talker. The snake was a smooth talker. So they were smooth of skin, and he was a smooth talker. And in case my kids watch this later, I'll say, smooth like butter. It's a BTS reference. So they were nude, not ashamed. The serpent was shrewd, but the shrewdness gets uncovered later in the chapter, and the snake has some consequences, so perhaps it's a little foreshadowing of what's going to happen. The serpent thought he was the wisest, but he was really the nudist of the group. So what does all this add up to anyway? Well, I take a few things from these two chapters, you know, chapters 2 and 3 of Genesis. One is God's got a sense of humor. Whoever wrote this down's got a sense of humor. They were putting in word plays. And so one thing that teaches me is don't take yourself so seriously, dirt man or dirt woman. Just don't take ourselves too seriously. We're just a bunch of dirt bags. And then also read the story for what it is, a story. Right? There are people out there, and some of them are going to a church right around the corner from where I live, where they're arguing, you know, the earth is only 6,000 years old, and God created things exactly like it says in Genesis 1 and 2, except that the two chapters have it in different orders. But no, never mind. Don't look behind the curtain. Right? That's a Wizard of Oz reference, right? Don't pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. Right? Don't look behind the curtain. Don't worry about the contradictions. But this has got to be, this is a scientific thing, and how, no, that's not what this is. And it's not how we're supposed to read it. We're supposed to read it as a story. That's what it is. First chapter, I think, is a big celebration of creation. Wow, look at all the things God did. And chapters 2 and 3 teach us a whole lot about ourselves and our relationship to God. We're a bunch of dirt people, but we do have God's breath. Right? Where else do you get talking snakes? I mean, later we get a talking donkey. I think it was the only two talking animals in the Bible. We are inspirited dirt. We belong in community. Remember, it was bad to be alone, bad to be alone. And we are rather shrewd or nude, depending on the occasion. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. God, we give you thanks for all of creation, for the stories of it, for the celebration of it, for the humor in it. And God, help us to be mindful of our place in your world, that we are dirt people, but we do have your breath infusing us, enlivening us. We are inspirited bodies, that we're made for one another, and that we're given wisdom from you. We give you thanks in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. As we prepare to come to Christ's table, invite us to sing together, "Let the whole creation cry." Welcome to Christ's table. At Christ's table, we find uncovered before us the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus all in one. The bread and cup symbolizing his body and blood, showing that he lived among us as one of us, but that the blood was shed, the body was broken. And yet now we celebrate in the light of his resurrection. On that night so long ago, Jesus took bread and he gave thanks. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, hamotzi lechem min haaretz. Blessed are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. And he gave it to them saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. Do this to remember me." And then he took a cup, and again he gave thanks. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, borei pri hagafen. Blessed are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who brings the creator of the fruit of the vine. And he gave it to them, saying, "Drink, all of you, for I tell you, this is my blood of the covenant, poured out for many for forgiveness of sins, and I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." The body of Christ broken for us. The blood of Christ shed for us. Thanks be to God for the gifts of God, for the people of God. Invitation today is all good gifts, and this is a reminder of God's blessings and gifts to us. And as we sing, as our opportunity to commit ourselves and recommit ourselves to receiving and blessing God for all good gifts. And I'll point out this one is in Chalice Praise, a little purple book. It's number 100. So let's sing. So let us go out into this punny creation that God's made for us and spread what joy we can, bring what comfort we can to a world that needs both. May God be above us to watch over us. May God be beneath us to lift us up. May God be ahead of us to lead us. May God be behind us to push us. May God be beside us to walk with us. May God be within us to love us forever. Amen.